This is the tragedy of America's history, is that now, in freedom, we embrace slavery, we embrace subservience, we embrace victimization, even as we're free.
The shooting of Michael Brown in 2014 in Ferguson, Missouri, prompted a U.S. national outcry against racism and police brutality, and still shapes the popular consciousness today. But much of the popularized narrative was simply not true. The slogan, "Hands up, don't shoot," was based on a falsehood. Brown had not surrendered with his hands up, and he had, in fact, struggled with Officer Darren Wilson for his gun, according to exhaustive witness interviews, ballistics, DNA evidence, and autopsy results, all detailed in a Justice Department report. The new documentary film, What Killed Michael Brown, explores how popular culture got this so wrong. It stars and is written by Hoover Institute senior fellow Shelby Steele and is directed by his filmmaker son Eli. In this episode, we sit down with Shelby and Eli Steele to discuss the film and why they argue that Amazon is censoring it.
This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Yanya Kellick. Shelby and Eli Steele, such a pleasure to have you on American Thought Leaders.
Thank you for having me, for having us.
Thank you for having us. It's a pleasure to be on here.
Shelby and Eli, you've created an incredibly powerful film. I'm frankly still digesting it, having screened it earlier this afternoon. Shelby, I want to talk about this concept of white guilt that you've been developing over years that frankly figures in very prominently in the film and, of course, in the events of past months, you would argue. Could you please speak to that to start us off?
Well, it just seems to me that one of the dynamics, I suppose, is the word, and another word I use sometimes is a symbiotic relationship between blacks and whites that came out of the 60s, when America, I call it the Great Confession, America confessed to centuries of collusion with the evil of racism. Wow. I don't know any other society in human history that's done anything remotely that honorable and difficult. And yet, when you do something, when you confess, then you give people a hammer to hit you with. And that hammer is white guilt. And we as blacks coming into our freedom in the 60s, winning the civil rights battle, civil rights laws, so forth. We, in a sense, I don't think we realized it consciously, but there was a choice. We could sort of rely on ourselves and develop hard, but suddenly we had in our hand a kind of moral weapon over the rest of society. You did it. You've confessed it yourself. You owe us. And so we began, as in Black America, we began to say, our power is our ability to extract obligation from whites. Lyndon Johnson, as if on cue, creates the Great Society, the war on poverty, public housing, school busing, expanded welfare payments, affirmative action, on and on. In responding to that, again, blacks sort of wielding that power, if you don't do that, you don't give us those things, you lose your innocence. You are illegitimate. You are morally illegitimate. That's a huge power to have. It's still there. We still rely on it. I think far, far too much. We've transformed institutions. Universities in America are different than they were back in the 60s and the 70s and so forth. We've changed the culture, sometimes for the good, sometimes for not for the good. But for blacks, this has been a tragedy because we've relied on white guilt as black power rather than rely on ourselves, discipline ourselves, develop, educate ourselves, become competitive with other people, join America rather than resist America. Rather than do that, we create an elite leadership that just, we call it the grievance industry, that manipulates white guilt. And whites are so in terror, that's the only word, of being seen as racist and losing their moral standing because of it, that they tend to pay off. We have a power to sort of shake down broader America. And so again, that I think is the framework that other things happen in around race.
Well, and on this point a little bit, you also argue in the film that this creates a common sense of a kind of victim mentality. Not just in Black communities, and it happens in all sorts of communities, but particularly because of this structure. How does that work exactly?
Well, when we realize that our victimization was in fact our source of power, because it gave us this moral leverage over whites. We took on a racial identity that I call victim-focused identity. So the Black identity today is victim-focused. If you want to be labeled an Uncle Tom, just say that Blacks are not victims. That's the most outrageous thing you can say to Blacks today, is that young Blacks and Black Lives Matter and so forth. We're not victims. We should not embrace victimization as an identity, because again, it renders us impotent. But we continue to do that, and to have this this terrible thing where you are defining proudly, with honor, that you're a victim. The price of having done that is that Blacks are farther behind whites today by every socioeconomic measure than they were in the 50s, before we got any of these, before white guilt was there to exploit. So it has not helped us. It's left us farther and farther behind. One thing I talk about in the film is that there's no... When I was growing up, there was no underclass, Black underclass. We were poor. We were segregated in a Black world. Everybody had a father. There was a coherent family life. These were communities where young people were encouraged to join America, even though that we knew everybody it was racist. The goal was to change it, to become a part of it, to make our contribution. 60 years of thinking of ourselves as victims has ruined that. So 80% of all children now are born, Black children are born without a father. A sad legacy of American, a sad legacy.
So, you know, and of course, these themes, you know, come out, frankly, again, I have to say this again, in a very powerful, but I would almost say a quiet way. I think the film is fascinating to me because it doesn't seem to force anything on you. It kind of takes you on this journey over years to Ferguson, to Chicago, to these other places that are important in, obviously, both of your lives. Eli, tell me, how is it that the idea for this film was conceived? And of course, Eli, you are the editor and the director of the film. So this, and of course, your mom and Shelby's wife is a producer. So this is a family affair. Tell me how this began.
I think a lot of it, we always wanted to work together. When she came out with the book, White Guilt, it was 2006. I wanted to see how we can maybe turn it into a movie. But if you read the book, it kind of hard to do that. And it wasn't until after I did my last documentary that he sat down and just said, okay, what would be a topic? What would be something that we could? Because one thing, the interesting thing about my father is that he, even though he does repeat a lot in his work, he always wants to go into new territory as much as possible. So we were looking for a subject matter, and Ferguson was that. And the reason why was because I was actually with him and a lot unfolding in real life. And what was shocking was every time more evidence came out, we found out that Michael Brown had been shot in the front, not in the back, as originally thought. Well, after the original narrative, they exploded out of that. But that didn't matter. The narrative, still the part of the truth, we call it in the film, still kept going and kept going. And I think for both of us, that was the first time we saw that happening in our society, and that was new. Because most of the time, if you're looking at shooting like Walter Scott, who was shot in the back and had a gun planted on him, nobody argues about that. But because there was no video evidence, and because there was, it was a fight over the narrative. And so we thought that it would be a great place to go in, examine, and find out what really happened. And not only that, try to find out the root cause.
Well, you know, it's also fascinating. You also talk about how there was this sort of, you know, kind of almost lack of dignity in that shooting. What you make the case in the film that, and I think it's compelling that racism wasn't a motivator in this, but then the fact that Michael Brown's body was on, you know, basically left in the street for such a long time, it made a lot of people, you know, reasonably upset at what they were seeing, and it was kind of reminiscent of things they'd heard about, perhaps in their childhood or in their family lore and so forth. It's very, very, again, I'm just being hit by the sort of the strength about. So congratulations on making a really, really excellent, excellent film. So I did mention, Shelby, I did mention that you make the case that racism wasn't the motivator. I think we can talk about this. The film goes way beyond this question, of course, into the present day. But I think even today there's people that still believe there was a stop, don't shoot, the hands up, and so forth. And we understand that that actually never happened based on, you know, a whole plethora of evidence. How is it that so many Americans might still believe this falsehood?
Well, because, again, we in Black America have this, as I was mentioning before, our victimization had become our identity. It's a victim-focused identity because we think that's where our power is. And so the reaction to this shooting, right away you saw a longing, a hunger for this to be an instance of racism, of that old American evil of racism that's plagued us for centuries now. There's a hunger for it, not a anger at it, but don't listen to other people. Michael Brown was a victim of racism. Because in believing that, I enhance Black power, which is this faith that in Black, that victimization is our source. So I'm expanding Black power when I argue that Michael Brown was a victim of racism. If I say he wasn't a victim of racism, had nothing to do with racism, it was a tragedy, but not a racial tragedy, then I'm denying Black power. I'm reducing it. I'm neutering it. And so I'm sure we will, in the film, we'll get that reaction. You are neutering us. You are revealing to us that that we're over-relying on our victimization. You will embarrass us. It's humiliating to talk that way about us. I understand that. I feel all of that. But nevertheless, that's the Michael Brown and the other incidents, the Trayvon Martin, George Floyd, the knee pressing down on the neck. These are all metaphors for Black victimization. And so we get this totally exciting, extravagant reaction when they happen from the Black communities, almost a kind of celebration. Because we know that's moral power that we can use in society. Yeah, and it's the only power we feel we have. And of course it won't really do that, but it gives us the illusion of having power. That's what's sad. At some point we have to acknowledge, we will have to acknowledge all of this. Victimization is not the way to move forward. Languishing there is not the way to go forward. Yes, it's important to know our history, but it's not important to make an identity out of the tragic things that happened to us. We need a new identity that faces freedom, embraces it, and all its possibilities. And it breaks my heart to see how off track we have, in a sense, become. But again, whites in America enable us in this avoidance. Because whites in America, when they see a Michael, they start all of a sudden, you know, to give money to, again, Amazon is giving $10 million to Black Lives Matter, but they're canceling us. What Amazon is saying is that we like things the way they are. You Blacks thinking of yourselves as victims, we'll give you a little money. You help our brand name. You make sure that people understand we're not racist. We're innocent of that old American evil. Amazon is free of all of that. And here's $10 million to prove it. This is how ugly things get when neither side has the courage, and I think it's all really in the end about courage, has the courage to sort of face this. Why couldn't Amazon say, for example, these guys made an earnest effort? It's by what reason would we say it can't be streamed, it can't be seen? Shouldn't it be in fact an opportunity to look in a new way at this old tenacious problem? But no, that'll take another generation or so. Right now, white America is so habituated to enabling Blacks, just giving them things, without asking anything. You know, a lot of the social programs that the government put forward might have actually worked if those programs had asked for something from Blacks, for higher grades, more discipline, more effort, more development. But we didn't. We asked nothing, and we got nothing. And I'm guilty there. I worked in three different government programs in the late 60s, early 70s. And I saw this pattern unfold.
You know, so let's talk about this censorship of your film. Actually, it kind of, you know, I learned a new word recently, something that's apparently millennials use a lot. I'm showing my age here, I guess, but the word is meta. And so, you know, basically by doing, by making this film and publishing it, what you're arguing is actually enacted by the streaming service that was supposed to put it up, right? It's this it's kind of a curiosity in that respect. But tell me a little bit, Eli, about what actually happened here. Was there some agreement that the film would be streamed and then it was canceled? Or explain to me why you believe you're being censored here.
Well, we did want to release the film during the election, during the time of the election, because we thought that race would play a significant role in it. So, a Christian production team and everything, the production team finished the film. We finished, around September 3rd and so forth. And at that time, because the movie was released down like on October 15th, which is today, we hope that you forget everything, but we were going to release the film today, and there were not very many platforms to take a film, which is just a short amount of time. I soon had to waiting time of 45 days, 90 days. Amazon, however, offers you a two or three week window to be film up to the public. And so we got the film up. And also, Amazon also is a platform. So if you want to have a store or anything, you should create your own platform, you go into the ecosystem. So I never thought that I would have to seek the permission of anybody. Because as long as you have a father, you should spell it. And so we got up on September 29th. By October 1st, it was put into content review. And this is my first time, and you probably understand what content review meant. And so I was thinking, oh, it's a technical issue. And, please let me know as soon as possible. Because the film, the file is like 150 gigabytes, and it takes like 4 or 5 days just to upload it. It's a huge file. And during this time, and to come with the problem with the fishing. But kept lying, and I kept sending emails, got nothing back, general answers or no answer. And finally, Tuesday, yesterday past Tuesday, they denied shipped the movie. It did not meet the quality, the content quality that we want for our platform. So you would not be able to get a movie on. You cannot appeal the decision. You cannot resubmit. So it's a very clear no. Like, it's over for the bother. If it was a technical issue, they would say, hey, it's just a caption file or something like that, and we upload. And because Amazon takes 50% of your pay, of your revenue. So they will obviously want to get as much content up there and make as much money as possible. And so that was shocking to see them really realize that the content review actually meant the story. They were looking at the story, and the story did not fit what they wanted to have on their platform. Or is it really a platform or a publishing platform? Because the behavior they're publishing now. And that shit is happening. Of course, these big tech companies are not only creating war within their own ecosystem, but actually determining what gets on there and what does not get on there. So that's more of a new evolution in our society. And because it weakens free speech, it weakens all of the protections that we have. So I'm now fucking this little. I'm very thankful to have an alternate society, but we did lose a lot. We were not allowed to enter the ecosystem that everybody knows, and everybody's familiar with, and everybody not even watching. But I would probably say they probably have anywhere from 30 to 40% of the market when it comes to watching content, and that is huge.
I understand. So, well, first of all, let's tell everyone how they can view the film. WhatKilledMichaelBrown.com. If you go to that site, I understand it's streaming on Vimeo, so there is a platform where you can buy the film and watch it. Shelby, Is there anything specific in the film that you can think of that might be objected to?
I think there's probably a lot. I think there's probably a lot in the film that if you are of the, they again, the $10 million I think they gave to Black Lives Matter is very telling. That's, I think, that is their vision of race in America. The Black Lives Matter sort of orientation. And I think that's what our film just in a thousand ways challenges that denounces it. Sees it really as the problem that Blacks have, that we have as a society, where companies like Amazon can be shaken down out of by people who demonstrate nothing more than Black anger. That the people, the crowd, the rioters, the protesters, call the shots. They say, if you go with us, we'll let you be morally legitimate. You're on the side of the good. And people who are against us are in collusion with racism and must be avoided. So something like what the Steeles have done, that's the enemy, according to them. We are apologists for that old racist America of Jim Crow laws and slavery and segregation and so forth. We're sort of saying that, forget about it, just move on with your lives. Obviously, that's not what we're saying, but we do mean get on with your lives as individual citizens in a free society. Find out what you love in life and go for it, develop. If one door is closed, find another one that's open. It's the same for everybody. And we need to accept that, and that our race is not going to open those doors. And it's not going to take us anywhere. You can take over the curriculum of universities, but then you don't have much of a curriculum left. You're going to be ignorant. There's no way around these things. So again, I think the idea that this is the case, upsets the sort of charming balance that that corporate America has. They're happy to see Black Lives Matter. Gives them a place for the payoff money to go. And we have to remember another variable. America is an extremely wealthy nation. And we can pay off and have paid off for victimization now for the last 60 years. And so we can keep these perversions really going because we have the wealth to do so. But again, any way you play the game, Blacks end up the losers. That's why we did this work. That's why we want this film to have a life, to make a statement quietly, but accurately, precisely make a statement. That day's got to come to an end. And I think there is certainly in Black America today a new consciousness, a new awareness. Call these people, call me Black conservative. I don't know if that moniker makes a lot of sense or not, but there are people who no longer subscribe to this victim-focused Black identity that has just mired us and ground us down in American life.
So, and Shelby, there's a whole lot of well-meaning people, from what I've seen, from people that I have talked to, who took to the streets following the killing of George Floyd and, you know, all the media attention that it got. And of course, I accept that some of that is certainly a reflection of this white guilt. But I imagine there's a lot of people who are just simply outraged and felt, you know, there's a big problem in society. And I think you suggest, and I've certainly done a bunch of research around this, that Black Lives Matter misrepresents what they stand for. And I'm wondering, is that how you explain it? What are your thoughts on this?
Well, I first of all want to echo what you say about the goodwill of the American people and people internationally, really, who demonstrated over the George Floyd situation, because it seemed so conspicuously to be a heinous and racist act. We'll see. The trial, I guess, begins not too far away, and the facts, I presume, will come out. But there is good. This is the you hit right on the dicey part here, because there are people of genuine goodwill, whites particularly, who around these issues, who want a better world, want peace between the races, want all this sort of judgment and castigation and anger and outrage to go to recede from our lives. There's goodwill. George Floyd was a perfect example. Within a week or so, the people of goodwill began to be used as a front for people who were violent, who were burning down buildings and setting off bombs and them getting in line and marching. And we certainly need to make a distinction there. I'm proud of those people who demonstrated out of a genuine goodwill. Thank you. It was a moment where there needed to be a human witness, and there was one. And I'm grateful for that. I'm proud that Americans did that. One of the points that I make in the things I write is that white Americans, since the 60s, when we had that great confession I talked about happening, have made, I believe, the greatest collective moral evolution ever made anywhere in the world, in human history. I was born and raised in a totally segregated society. Segregated schools, segregated neighborhoods, segregated, couldn't go to hotels, couldn't work, any number of things. I'd be here all day talking about all of the racist policies that I grew up with. That's not America today. Today I go anywhere I want. The most stunning event in Black American history was not slavery, it's freedom. That's what we don't have a lot of experience with. We got free in the 60s. We say we're not because we just don't know what to do with freedom. We don't understand the level of responsibility people have to take when they become free. The things that they are responsible for their fate, not other people. We keep pushing this victimization to hide from that. And we haven't done a good job with freedom. We're still trying to deny that we're in freedom. Why? Because we're human beings. Human beings we're all afraid of that level of responsibility that freedom imposes on us. We all balk at that. Well, Blacks are no different. They balk, and you talk to people in the young Black Lives Matter today, and they'll tell you how. All they'll do is go on and make the case for victimization. When we're swimming in freedom, it's everywhere. Every institution in American life is begging us to join, become a part, swearing that we will evolve. Well, that moral evolution is, I think, in history will be understood as a profound turning point in human affairs. Where else has that ever happened? That I'm sitting here today, given where I was as a kid, no one could have foreseen that. And we need to take that into our calculations about the future, about what we're, how we're going to move ahead in freedom. But we have all this opportunity. That's I think what our problem is. We just really have to calculate that in now and put the focus on freedom rather than on vindication and justice. And justice is another word that annoys me, because it has nothing to do with justice. It's a way to avoid to keep saying I'm a victim.
Eli, why don't you jump in?
One thing that this is very interesting is that nobody really talks about the effect of Black Lives Matter on white people. During this week, I was thinking of email blasts to people who had subscribed to the website. And one woman who I had gone to college with wrote me an email out of the blue. I never really talked to her in college. I never really, I've seen her in maybe 10 years. And she writes this email basically accusing me of being pro-racist. Blaming Michael Brown. And this was like on Wednesday or Tuesday. So obviously she had not seen the film. But what was fascinating, I never even responded to the email, but what was fascinating was that shift in her, that she felt compelled to use this anti-racist language towards me, and actually not call me a racist, but a pro-racist. I mean, what does that even mean? Like I'm actively being a racist. And, you know, she has no, I mean, she knows me enough that she knows that I'm Black, I'm Jewish, I'm all these things. Not that I'm, doesn't extend me from being a racist, but the fact is, if you just look at my work, if you're looking right down, there was a shock. And that's the very danger, because you know, my father is talking about the progress the Americans have made over the years. Now you have Amazon, and you have this young woman making this shift where something like our film is racist because it has a bigger narrative. And how do you, as a society, recover from that if people continue to go down that slope? We've been there. It's not pretty when people go to that level of just reducing everybody to, you know, to the external quality. And that's the danger that we face as a society today.
Well, you know, this just makes me think of, you know, one of the contentions in the film that's repeated a couple of times is, I think, okay, let me see if I have this right, because many concepts, but I believe you said that America's original sin is to use race as a means to power. Or am I conflating two things here? I believe that's what was said. And the other piece that I think is connected to this very deeply is what is this anti-racism that's being described exactly? Maybe Shelby.
I don't know what anti-racism, except to what it would literally mean is, most people I know are anti-racist. And so it's hard for me. There's some of the talk about race today is so convoluted that it's hard to understand. And that's a concept that I've heard now a lot, but I don't have any idea of what it really means. It's probably ultimately it's a way to call somebody a name. And tie them, if you're against racism, you're a racist. So there is in certain circles today a kind of desire to find new ways to give racism light, to keep it alive as a smear, something we can use to smear people. So that all sorts of things become racist. If I work with a Black pencil rather than a white pencil, then it's because I'm inherently in some way enthralled to white supremacy. And silly things. When you avoid the truth, when you avoid reality, which is that blacks are suffering because they're underdeveloped, not because they're not free, but because they're underdeveloped. That's the truth. I'll stand by that. That's demonstrable. We have after 60 years of affirmative action in universities, black students have the lowest grade point average and the highest dropout rate of any student group in American universities. Well, you can talk about anti-racism all you want, but to me, that's a failure to understand that our challenge is development, is education, is competing, not just to compete with other black students. As my father told me when I was in college, if you want to get better, you pick the smartest, best kid in the class and go after him or her. Don't say, I'm going to measure myself against just all the other black students, or I'm going to pick some other form of measurement. Well, we've got to join this world. We've got to join modernity itself. That's the challenge of people who come from backgrounds of groups that have been oppressed for centuries, cut out of civilization. We have to join civilization. And that's an issue in the third world. It's an issue in Europe. It's an issue certainly in America. How to bring people who weren't born in modern civilization, modernity. They come forward quite willingly. The desire to get to America and make a life is almost universal in this world. Well, we black Americans are already here. It's our country. We built it along with everybody else. For goodness sakes, let's join it. Let's give it credit where credit is due. It has grappled with this race problem. We have made enormous progress with it. Michael Brown was not a victim of racism. He was a victim of a tragic coming together of circumstances, his own loss of temper, his own assault of the police officer, his own charging the police officer once again, even after he'd been shot. You usually get shot when you do that. That's not racism. And we need to stop. We need to just stop that. People are already wearing thin on that. We are just not that oppressed anymore. And there is no, in American policing today, there is no sort of unspoken rule that I'm looking for opportunities to shoot and kill black people. That just is not the case. We interviewed some in the film, policemen and so forth. These are all devices designed to keep us mired in the idea of ourselves as victims. This is the tragedy of America's history, is that now, in freedom, we embrace slavery, we embrace subservience, we embrace victimization, even as we're free. That's our problem, that's America's problem, and we all need to face it. It isn't going to go away. We can put whatever dress we want on it. It's not going to go away. And we're not going to ever be rewarded for being victims. We're going to be rewarded for taking charge of our lives, making something of ourselves. We're going to be rewarded for the same thing everybody is rewarded for. We're no different than anybody else. We've got to accept that. We've got to live that way. And of course, here's the point. Many, 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 many minorities do live as individuals and go after their dreams and achieve them. There are blacks in every walk of life today who are doing amazing things. The country would not be what it is without them. There you are. That's the model we need to live by, it seems to me.
Well, and something that's really amazing about the film is that you go, you know, aside from perhaps, you know, Bob Woodson, who's in the film, who we've had on the show a number of times, but you go to talk to all sorts of local people in these communities, in Ferguson, St. Louis. We actually learn a lot about the realities of how Ferguson sits among these different communities in the St. Louis area. We learn about Chicago, and we learn about some of these people who have made that step that you were just describing, which are kind of like, you know, incredible. Like one of the Bentley twins, I forget his name right now, you know, being kind of, you know, inspired after coming out of prison, and as a community, identified as a community leader through Pastor Booth, I think it is, you know, just amazing and powerful testimonials to this process. So how did you, Eli, how did you, you know, decide on who you were going to speak with? I mean, I assume we're only seeing a small subsection of the people you actually talked to, but how did you actually locate all of these people that are in the film?
We keep a quote that first because Ferguson just went through baptism by fire in 2014. And after the media left, after the outsiders left, they didn't really want to talk anymore. It was time that there's already been another documentary made. In fact, the psychological stuff, God, another documentary, which I don't blame them for. I used to live around the corner from where Nicole Stimson was murdered by O.C. Stimson. So I was, you know, people just taking pictures, people, every anniversary of somebody who's come to the thing. It was like that, but we had to show up and just start knocking on doors. And, you know, we gave an interview to people who she talked to and so forth. But kind of what we were looking for, we were looking for the voices that were not heard. What they call the unrest of 2014. And I really want to find the voice, because a lot of the voices have been silent, or ignored, or they face the question of black. They would face consequences of species truth in an atmosphere where the narrative, the whole narrative of ancestors, she was governing everything. And it's a small thing. You speak up against that, you get paid twice. So we really wanted to speak out to those kind of people. And so that's what I'm proud of about this film, is that I think it's a pretty rare film where you don't have, you know, black elite or black, you know, academic, except my father. You have all these people dominating the narrative. It's really the local people, the salt of the earth type of people. And I think what we do, though, as filmmakers, is that we're coming in with the perspective of you want to hear what you have to say. And we're going to ask you questions for the mainstream people that we're not asking. And so I think that's why you get a lot of fresh perspectives, a lot of new things. So that's what makes the film, I think, very comprehensive, is that you're hearing a lot of new things. And it's refreshing in a way, because you know you're not being lied to. You know, the people are not pushing the agenda. You know, the people, they want to say what they have to say. And so that's what we're proud of. It's a very diverse way of multi-black.
So, you know, Eli, you mentioned the media. I think in the film, you also make the case that the many of our mainstream media are kind of married to this, you know, victimization narrative, systemic racism narrative. And Shelby, is this something that's kind of ubiquitous and that's the reason it's so much in the media, or is there some other reason?
That this narrative, you mean, is sort of adhered to by the media?
Yes.
Yes, because it's the same thing that Amazon is, why they've done what they did. It's a sort of cowering, it's white guilt. It's to live under the accusation, just because you're white, that you're a racist, is the problem. And so without really worrying, thinking about it, that's a pressure. And so whites live under that pressure. And so they're constantly on the lookout for opportunities to demonstrate that they are not racist and to win their innocence. Their great mission is to restore innocence that was lost way back there when America confessed to what it had done. And we've really underrated the power of that socially in American life, culturally and otherwise. It is a huge, white guilt is a huge power that invades almost every walk of life, where whites now are in whatever position they're in. They have to figure out a way to, they have to deal with diversity. They have to deal with inclusion. They have to do, somehow or other, they're visited with this reminder that they're white and that as a minority, I have a certain power there that I can use to and you better go along with it. So the media takes the script of Black victimization and adheres to it so that they won't be called a racist. So their goal is not to, they don't care about Black people. They care about their own innocence, their own legitimacy, and that's one of the tragedies of American racial policies, is that they're all concerned with white innocence rather than with Black development. And four centuries of oppression did to us as Blacks is to underdevelop us. How do you come out of that and you're going to be, my father was allowed to go to the third grade, that's it. He had to teach himself to read and write. He did. But you look at the whole race of people treated in that way. Well, what we need is development. What we get from the media is their preoccupation with whether or not they're innocent, whether or not they're racist. And it's totally preoccupied with that. Political correctness is nothing but a sort of white self preoccupation with innocence. And it gets us nowhere. But it gives whites they are as stuck to innocence as Black people are stuck to victimization, and will not entertain anything in between, anything that mitigates that in any way. And so the media, I don't know when they will be interesting. The battle has to be fought out there. And we have to demand that you not, just because someone is Black and because they're a victim, does not mean they have truth. Here's the dirty little secret. White Americans have lost their moral confidence. They behave like people don't. I'm not quite sure. After all, they've accused us of racism for centuries. I'm not sure that I can't take our innocence for granted anymore. I've got to find little things to do to prove that we're innocent. Well, a lot of it, what goes on is just a lack of confidence that I'm not a racist. And in fact, it's important for me to think that I am a racist in order not to be one. So when you and you're Black and you see whites confused like that, that's an opportunity. I'm going to come in and demand that you set up a diversity program over there and hire all my relatives. I'm going to demand this. I'm going to demand that. That's my power, your lack of confidence. And we play those games, obviously way too much in American life. All we try to do in the film is say, here it is. Here's what is really happening. When you see this poor boy shot and killed, and And within moments, people were screaming that he was executed, that he was assassinated. Victimization. Right away, the grabbing for power. His body hadn't been removed yet, and there was already a power grab in play. All of his friends getting this sort of these poetic truths, these falsehoods together to, again, white cop, black victim, oh my God, racist, America is still a racist society. When are we going to get exhausted and tired of all that? I hope I live to see it.
Well, and one more question, just as we're finishing up here. You somehow managed to escape that, I guess, mentality. Maybe you never had it. So my first question is, how do you think that happened? And two, you know, what is your advice to Americans?
Well, I came to it naturally. My family was very much involved in the civil rights movement. We were founding members of CORE, of Congress for Racial Equality. I grew up thinking it, but the first people I began to read seriously were people like James Baldwin and Richard Wright and Ralph Ellison. And so I read and thought Booker T. Washington, Frederick Douglass, Malcolm X. I sort of grew up thinking about these things with a kind of obsession, I suppose. And I still have it. I still involuntarily think about this. Am I missing something? Am I overlooking something? What is really, really true? What I have discovered is that what I'm really doing is trying to see clearly the human condition. Nothing, no insight I've ever had, no understanding I've ever come to that isn't grounded in the human condition. Blacks, after all, at the end of the day, are humans. Whites, at the end of the day, are humans. They react. They're driven by the same forces and the same anxieties, the same fears. So, just from the point of view of writing and being, this is what long is to sort of come to terms and to learn things about what it means to be a human being.
And so, what is the next step? You kind of make some suggestions in the film, I think, but to someone watching this interview right now, and maybe getting a little inspired by what you're saying, maybe getting ready to go to your website and watch the film. What's your advice?
My advice is to keep an open mind and to see it. Try to learn something from it. And I suppose my bottom line advice is trust yourself, your own instincts, your own sense of what life means, what things mean. Trust yourself. It doesn't mean you lie to you. It means you really put yourself at risk, your beliefs at risk, and see what fate brings. And trust yourself to figure that out. That's I think what we all have to do. So I hope this film, I really hope and pray we this is what we were trying for, is a film that enables to simply trust the people, to trust themselves, to look at this in a different way. This is what we're not all black victims and white racists. Much different than that. We're much more complex and much more of a human story than a racial story. After all, race has no meaning in itself. And as we say, race is always a means, never an end, always a means to power. If I'm playing with race, I'm trying to get something. It's never an end in itself. So be careful. Don't see yourself trying to make something out of race. You may be embarking on a corruption of some kind.
Eli, any final thoughts?
One thing that's very interesting because he started writing, speaking when I was probably about 15 years old, and started into a lot of the speeches, whether in college, Cambridge, or somewhere else. There's always that one student who stands up and says to him, "What is the solution? How do you fix it?" And what they do is they ask that question as a race to dismiss him. But all it does is feel that they're not really dealing with what he's saying. He's saying that you, that person, are the solutions. You're the one that has to wake up every morning. You're the one that has, as you say in the Black community, we still say you have two hands, you have 2 feet, you have 2 ears, you have 2 eyes, you have a mouth, you have a brain. What more do you need? I mean, you have all, I mean, the human body is amazing what we can do. And the mind needs to just execute, needs to have a dream, a passion to move forward. And that is not true. We're not saying that you are a factory and you are by yourself. No, what we're saying is the more you develop yourself, the more other people help you. And I know that in my own life, if I had not gone into Ferguson, if I had not developed myself as a filmmaker and I had not gone into Ferguson, those people would not help me. Because there would be nothing to help. You can't help somebody who's helpful. And so they help. And here we are. We have a movie.
Shelby and Eli Steele, such a pleasure to have you on.
Such a pleasure to be on. I enjoyed myself. Thanks so much.
Thank you. I really enjoyed the conversation. So thank you.